Welcome back to the Hurricane Utah Adult Religion class, sponsored by the Hurricane Utah North Stake of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. My name is Mike Parker, and I'm the instructor for the class. The Hurricane Adult Religion class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures of the Restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. Dates, times, and location are available on the class website. Links to the class website are available in the show notes for this video. On the website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint slide presentation, and handouts that I distribute in class. And please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for these sites and the materials on them. If you enjoyed this lesson, please click the like button and share it with a friend. And subscribe if you want to be notified when new content is posted to this channel. In this lesson, we'll be studying day one of the ministry of Jesus Christ among the people of Nephi, the record of which is found in 3 Nephi chapters 8 through 18. There are two named individuals in this lesson. The first and most important is the Lord Jesus Christ, the resurrected Son of God, the God of Israel, and the God of the whole earth. Everything we've read in the Book of Mormon up to this point has been essentially a prologue to Christ's appearance to the descendants of Lehi. It's the crowning event of the narrative of the Book of Mormon. It's important not just for its teachings, but for its witness that Jesus of Nazareth is the literal resurrected Son of God, as the New Testament Gospels claim he is. The second named individual is Nephi 3, the prophet who kept the Nephite records and wrote the history of Jesus' appearance to the people of Nephi. He was called as the first of 11 disciples of the Lord in the New World. The events in this lesson can be divided into six sections. Great calamities and thick darkness appeared in Lehi's promised land at the time of Christ's death in the Old World. The voice of Christ spoke to the people who were in the darkness. Jesus Christ appeared to the people in Bountiful and set forth his doctrine. Jesus gave the sermon at the temple. Jesus taught about the law of Moses and the gathering of Israel. Jesus ministered to the people. The calamities at the opening of this lesson took place throughout all the lands inhabited by Book of Mormon peoples. Jesus appeared to the people of Nephi at the temple in the land Bountiful. The narrative in this lesson commenced at the start of the 34th year since the signs of the birth of Christ, circa AD 30, and concluded at the end of that same year, when Jesus Christ appeared to the people of Nephi. Recapping from our last lesson, the reign of the judges came to an end when the Nephite central government collapsed and the Nephite people separated into tribes. Nearly all people had become wicked. Only a few righteous people remained. The prophet Nephi preached and performed great miracles, but only a few people accepted his message and repented. This context is critical to understanding the massive destruction and many deaths that took place in 3 Nephi chapter 8. Despite repeated prophetic warnings of destruction, the Nephites had descended into a state of awful wickedness and were ripe for destruction. At the beginning of 3 Nephi chapter 8, 33 years had passed since the signs of Christ's birth. As the 34th year commenced, the people anticipated the 3 days of darkness that Samuel the Lamanite prophesied would occur. On the fourth day of the 34th year, there arose a great storm, such an one as never had been known in all the land. The storm was accompanied by thunder, lightning, whirlwinds, and earthquakes. Many great and notable cities were burned, collapsed, were buried, sunk into the ground or sea, or suffered great damage. many people were killed by the storms and devastation. The destruction was great and terrible in the land southward, but it was even worse in the land northward, where the whole face of the land was changed and became deformed. These verses indicate that the face or surface of the land northward was changed and deformed, but not its shape. Cities were buried and new mountains created, but the land masses themselves did not shift around. The calamities included high winds, thunder, and lightning. There is no mention of rain or floods, although the text does mention cities being sunk, either in the sea or some other body of water. This seems to suggest that the destruction was caused by volcanic eruptions accompanied by earthquakes. Volcanic eruptions are sometimes accompanied by lightning produced by static electricity, a phenomenon called a dirty thunderstorm. Earthquakes can also cause tsunami that flood coastal towns, as well as liquefaction, in which the soil becomes saturated with water and buildings collapse or even sink into the ground. The cataclysmic destruction lasted about 3 hours, after which the land was covered by a vapor of smoke and of darkness that was not only tangible, but also blocked out the sunlight, prevented the ignition of fires of any kind, and killed people by overpowering them. This darkness lasted for 3 days. If this destruction was caused by volcanic disturbances, then these mists of darkness could have been dust, ash, and cinders, along with carbon dioxide and sulfur dioxide. These could have blocked out the sun, prevented fires from being kindled, and caused human beings and animals to asphyxiate. This video was shot at noon in Iceland when the Grímsvötn volcano erupted in May 2011. It shows what Icelanders call Öskumyrkur, ash darkness. I apologize to any Icelanders because I've probably mispronounced those words. The survivors in the Promised Land cried out in the darkness, mourning and howling and weeping and wishing that they had repented and listened to the prophets, that perhaps their mothers, daughters, and children could have been spared. After that, there was a voice heard among all the inhabitants of the earth upon all the face of this land. It was the voice of Jesus Christ, announcing that destruction had come upon the land and its cities because of the iniquity and abominations of the people. He pleaded with those who had been spared to return unto me and repent of your sins and be converted and receive eternal life. He declared, "Behold, I am Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I created the heavens and the earth and all things that in them are. I was with the Father from the beginning. I am in the Father, and the Father in me, and in me hath the Father glorified his name." Jesus declared that the law of Moses had been fulfilled in him, and that instead of animal sacrifices, ye shall offer for a sacrifice unto me a broken heart and a contrite spirit. He promised that those who repenteth and cometh unto me as a little child, him will I receive. After these sayings, there was silence in the land for the space of many hours. The people were so astonished that they ceased lamenting and howling. After many hours had passed, the voice of Christ was heard again. This time he told the people of his desire to gather his people Israel, as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and yet they had refused. The people began to howl again, but after 3 days their mourning turned to joy, praise, and thanksgiving when the darkness dispersed and the earthquakes ceased. Mormon concluded his account of the destruction and Jesus' words by adding some commentary about what had happened. He explained that the more righteous among the people had been saved from destruction. All the things that had happened were the fulfillment of the prophecies that were written on the brass plates. At the end of chapter 10, Mormon wrote that Jesus appeared and ministered to the people of Nephi in the ending of the 34th year, nearly a full year after the cataclysms, darkness, and the voice of the Savior. At the end of the year, a great multitude of people, about 2,500 men, women, and children, were gathered around the temple in the land Bountiful. They were marveling and wondering one with another, and were showing one to another the great and marvelous change which had taken place, and conversing about Jesus Christ. What was the great and marvelous change? In a paper published by Interpreter, Clifford P. Jones proposed, quote, "There is significant textual evidence to suggest that it refers to the essential infinite change wrought by the atonement. If the phrase, the great and marvelous change, is more likely a reference to the atonement, the most great and marvelous change ever to occur in the history of the world, then this change may describe a multitude that purposely gathered to the temple for a spiritual purpose, and not a random group that came to a public place to share the common experience of surviving the changes to the land." Unquote. Everything recorded in 3 Nephi chapters 11 to 26 took place at the temple in Bountiful. This was not by accident. The narrative is firmly grounded in the temple and covenant worship. The people suddenly heard a voice speaking as if it came out of heaven. At first, they didn't understand what the voice was saying, but they did know that it was not a harsh voice, neither was it a loud voice. Nevertheless, and notwithstanding it being a small voice, it did pierce them that did hear to the center, insomuch that there was no part of their frame that it did not cause to quake. Yea, it did pierce them to the very soul, and did cause their hearts to burn. They were able to understand the voice the third time it spoke, because they did open their ears to hear it. The voice said, "Behold, my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, in whom I have glorified my name. Hear ye him." The Father had used similar language to introduce the Son immediately after Jesus' baptism and at the Mount of Transfiguration. In this instance, he added the phrase, "in whom I have glorified my name," something he had promised to do a few days before Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. At that moment, Jesus descended out of heaven, wearing a white robe. He stretched out his hand to the assembled people and declared, quote, "Behold, I am Jesus Christ, whom the prophets testified shall come into the world. And behold, I am the light and the life of the world. And I have drunk out of that bitter cup which the Father hath given me, and have glorified the Father in taking upon me the sins of the world, in the which I have suffered the will of the Father in all things from the beginning." Unquote. That was 3 Nephi chapter 11, verses 10 through 11. Jesus' self-introduction perfectly summarizes his role and mission. His coming was foretold by the prophets. He is the light and the life of the world, has paid for the sins of all mankind, and has glorified the Father by being completely obedient to him at all times since before the world was. The assembled people remembered the prophecies that Christ would show himself to them, and they fell to the earth in awe, respect, and worship. Their collective act echoes Lehi's dream of the Tree of Life, in which he saw multitudes of people who did press their way forward, continually holding fast to the rod of iron, until they came forth and fell down and partook of the fruit of the tree. The tree represented the love of God manifested to the world by being born himself into mortality. The reaction of the people at Bountiful to personally witnessing God himself was to prostrate themselves at his feet. Jesus commanded the people to come forward and touch the wounds in his side, hands, and feet, "that ye may know that I am the God of Israel, and the God of the whole earth, and have been slain for the sins of the world." All the people did so, and they did know of a surety, and did bear record, that it was he of whom it was written by the prophets that should come. They then fell to the ground and worshipped Jesus. The people would have known that he was divine. They saw him descend from heaven. But they would not have known he was physical and the resurrected Messiah unless they examined him for themselves. The wounds on his body witnessed that he died on the cross. His presence among them witnessed that he was raised from the dead. Only God himself could accomplish such a thing. The importance of bearing record of what they had seen and heard and experienced appears repeatedly throughout the account of Jesus' appearance. Those who have received a witness of Christ are obligated to share that witness. Jesus then called forth Nephi and 11 other men, gave them authority to baptize, and set forth the proper manner of baptism. He taught that those who repent and desire baptism shall stand in the water with one who has authority, and the one having authority shall say, "Having authority given me of Jesus Christ, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen." After which he will immerse the person being baptized, and then draw him out of the water. The exact wording of the baptismal prayer was amended in the Articles and Covenants of the Church, which is now section 20 in the Doctrine and Covenants. It now begins with, "having been commissioned of Jesus Christ." The difference could be simply one of translation. Being commissioned and having authority given are essentially the same thing. Or it could reflect the fact that the Nephite disciples were given authority directly by Christ himself, while priesthood holders today receive it through a line of authority that leads back to Christ. Jesus explained to the people of Nephi the authority and manner of baptism, so that there shall be no disputations among you concerning the points of my doctrine. For he that hath the spirit of contention is not of me, but is of the devil. His teaching doesn't mean that followers of Christ can't have differences of opinion or disagreements over interpretations of Scripture. Rather, disagreements should be handled peaceably, agreeing to disagree and deferring to proper priesthood authority where needed. The Nephites' doctrinal disagreements frequently damaged or even destroyed their church and society. This specifically is what Jesus was speaking out against. Jesus declared, "This is my doctrine, and it is the doctrine which the Father hath given unto me. And I bear record that the Father commandeth all men everywhere to repent and believe in me, and to be baptized. They who do so, the Father will visit with fire and with the Holy Ghost, for they buildeth upon my rock." Jesus also taught, "Ye must repent and be baptized in my name and become as a little child." The importance of becoming like a child would be emphasized when Jesus blessed the children later that same day. Jesus then delivered his sermon at the temple. There are four parallel versions of this discourse. The best known version is the Sermon on the Mount, found in the Gospel of Matthew in chapters 5 through 7. There is an alternate, shorter account of this sermon in the 6th chapter of Luke's Gospel. This is called the Sermon on the Plain. The third version is the Sermon at the Temple, recorded in 3 Nephi chapters 12 through 14. The fourth account is Joseph Smith's revision of Matthew chapters 5 through 7. There are differences between JST Matthew 5 through 7 and 3 Nephi 12 through 14. There is no one true version of Jesus' sermon. Rather, there are several versions, each of which provides its own unique perspective. The differences between the versions of the sermon in Matthew and in 3 Nephi are subtle, but often quite profound. Some differences are due to the Book of Mormon's post-resurrection setting. For example, in Matthew 5:18, Jesus taught that one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. In the version of that saying in 3 Nephi 12:18, that was changed to the past tense, because Jesus had fulfilled the law by the time he appeared to the people of Nephi. In the Lord's Prayer, given in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus prayed to the Father to let his kingdom come to earth. When he prayed with the people of Nephi, he did not repeat that phrase, because the Father's kingdom had already come in the form of Jesus' sacrifice and bodily resurrection. The passage in 3 Nephi, chapter 12, verses 46 to 47, is unique to Jesus' sermon at the temple. It is not found in any other account, including Joseph Smith's revision of KJV Matthew 5. Some differences were due to Jesus speaking to a Nephite audience. For example, the sermon at the temple changes the unit of currency from the Roman quadrans, translated farthing in the King James Bible, to the senine, the standard weight used among the people of Nephi. For emphasis, the sermon at the temple also adds a comment about the impossibility of paying debt while incarcerated in prison. The practice of making solemn oaths by the name of the Lord's city of Jerusalem was common in Galilee and Judea, but not among the descendants of Lehi. So Jesus did not mention his commandment to not swear by the name of Jerusalem in his sermon at Bountiful. Some differences are based on a culture of written law versus one of oral tradition. Jews in New Testament era Jerusalem had been the recipients of hundreds of years of oral interpretation of the Law of Moses by groups like the Pharisees, a practice which the Nephites seem to have avoided. Five times in the Sermon at the Temple, the oral traditions Jesus cited in his Sermon on the Mount were replaced by or supplemented with references to the written law. Jesus' Sermon at the Temple also has additional beatitudes that are not included in the Sermon on the Mount. 3 Nephi chapter 12, verses 1b through 2, quote, "Blessed are ye if ye shall give heed unto the words of these 12 whom I have chosen from among you to minister unto you and to be your servants, and unto them I have given power that they may baptize you with water. And after that ye are baptized with water, behold, I will baptize you with fire and with the Holy Ghost. Therefore, blessed are ye if ye shall believe in me and be baptized, after that ye have seen me and know that I am. And again, more blessed are they who shall believe in your words, because that ye shall testify that ye have seen me and that ye know that I am. Yea, blessed are they who shall believe in your words and come down into the depths of humility and be baptized, for they shall be visited with fire and with the Holy Ghost, and shall receive a remission of their sins." Unquote. These additional beatitudes teach that while it is blessed to have seen Jesus and know that he exists, it is more blessed, a higher virtue, to believe the testimony of those who have seen without having seen ourselves. Another interesting feature of Jesus' sermon in 3 Nephi 12 through 14 is that elements in it continually reoccur in his teachings in chapters 5 through 27 and in the writings of Mormon and Moroni. Jesus and the Nephite authors who came after him expanded and commented on the teachings in the Sermon at the Temple. An example of this is the following passage from Jesus' sermon. "If the salt shall lose its savor, it shall be good for nothing. Be a light unto this people. I am not come to destroy the law or the prophets. In me it hath all been fulfilled." These teachings appear in the reverse sequence, a chiasm, in Jesus' later instructions to the people of Nephi. The law is fulfilled that was given to Moses. I do not destroy the prophets. I am the law. Ye are a light unto this people, and a remnant of Joseph. Gentiles, who will not turn to Christ, will be as salt that has lost its savor. For a more detailed exploration of the Sermon on the Mount and the Sermon at the Temple, see my notes to Lesson 6 in the New Testament course. I'll leave a link to those in the show notes below. After the Sermon at the Temple, Jesus taught about the Law of Moses and the gathering of Israel in 3 Nephi chapters 15 through 16. Jesus first taught the multitude. He perceived that the people did not understand what he meant when he had taught, old things are done away, and all things have become new. So he directly and explicitly taught them, the law is fulfilled that was given unto Moses. As the premortal Jehovah, Jesus himself said that he gave the law and covenanted with my people Israel, and he had therefore fulfilled and put an end to the law. That didn't mean, though, that every previous commandment that he had given was null and void. The prophecies and teachings of the prophets were still in force, as was Jesus' covenant with Israel, which was not all fulfilled. The law of Moses may have come to an end, but that meant that Jesus himself was the law and the light, and those who believe in him must still keep his commandments. The performances and ordinances of the law of Moses, animal sacrifice, observance of specific holy days, restrictions in diet and clothing, etc., had come to an end. But the commandments that predated the Mosaic law, those against murder, theft, lying, and sexual sin, commandments to aid the poor, love one's neighbor, observe the Sabbath day, etc., those still applied, and they still apply today. Jesus then taught his 12 Nephite disciples. The Father had given the descendants of Lehi the land of promise as their inheritance, but he did not command Jesus to tell the people in Jerusalem about the descendants of Lehi or any of the other scattered tribes of Israel. The Father only commanded Jesus to tell the people in Jerusalem, "Other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd." The people in Jerusalem didn't understand what Jesus had meant by this because of their stiff-neckedness and unbelief. It was because of the iniquity of the people at Jerusalem that the descendants of Lehi and the other tribes had been separated from them. Jesus then declared to the people of Nephi, "Ye are they of whom I said, other sheep I have, which are not of this fold." The people in Jerusalem believed that Jesus' other sheep were the Gentiles, but the Gentiles did not hear Jesus' voice. Instead, they would be converted through the preaching of Jesus' disciples in Jerusalem. Jesus also declared that he had other sheep which are not of this land, and that he would go to them, and they shall hear my voice, and shall be numbered among my sheep, that there may be one fold and one shepherd. Jesus commanded his disciples to write the things he had just taught, so that in the time of the fullness of the Gentiles, his words might go unto the Gentiles and from them to scattered Israel, so that they would be gathered in. He prophesied that in the latter day shall the truth come unto the Gentiles who had scattered and smitten and afflicted his people, Israel. The Gentiles, he foretold, would eventually reject the fullness of my gospel and turn to wickedness, at which time the Lord would remember my covenant which I have spoken unto my people, O house of Israel, and I will bring my gospel unto them. The Gentiles in the last days who repent will be numbered among the people of Israel. Those who do not shall be as salt that hath lost its savor. When that time comes, the prophecy of Isaiah will be fulfilled that Israelites and Gentiles shall see eye to eye, and all the ends of the earth shall see the salvation of God. After having instructed the people and his disciples, Jesus intended to return to his Father and to show myself unto the lost tribes of Israel. He told the people to return to their homes and ponder upon the things which I have said, and ask the Father in my name that ye may understand and prepare your minds for the morrow, and I come unto you again. The people were in tears, though, and did look steadfastly upon him, as if they would ask him to tarry a little longer with them. Filled with deep compassion, Jesus asked them to bring any sick and disabled individuals to him, declaring, "For I see that your faith is sufficient that I should heal you." He healed all who were brought to him, and both they who had been healed and they who were whole did bow down at his feet and did worship him. And as many as could come for the multitude, did kiss his feet, insomuch that they did bathe his feet with their tears. The scriptures repeatedly teach that each of us must become as a little child, meaning we must humble ourselves, be teachable, and follow the Savior. Jesus had given that very commandment to the people in Bountiful earlier that day. The account at the end of 3 Nephi chapter 17 is one expression of how deeply the Savior loves children and their innocence. He commanded the people to bring their little children to him and that everyone should kneel. Jesus himself also knelt and prayed using words that were so great and marvelous that they could not be written or spoken or even conceived in the heart. The people were filled with inconceivable joy, and Jesus' joy at the people's faith was so great that he openly wept. Jesus then took their little children one by one and blessed them and prayed unto the Father for them, and he wept again. He then said to the people, "Behold your little ones." The heavens opened, and angels descended in a pillar of fire, a description of the glory and brilliance of God and other divine beings. The angels and the fire encircled the children, and the angels ministered to the children. Jesus then commanded his 12 Nephite disciples to bring bread and wine. He broke and blessed the bread, offered it to his disciples, and commanded them to give it to the multitude. He then told his disciples that, after he had departed, they were to ordain men who would administer it to those who had been baptized. The symbolism of the bread, Jesus said, was, "In remembrance of my body, which I have shown unto you, and it shall be a testimony unto the Father, that ye do always remember me. And if ye do always remember me, ye shall have my spirit to be with you." Jesus next administered wine to the disciples, and the disciples in turn administered it to the people, and they were filled. He taught his disciples that they were blessed for partaking of the wine, "For this is fulfilling my commandments, and this doth witness unto the Father that ye are willing to do that which I have commanded you." His followers were to partake of it in remembrance of my blood, which I have shed for you, that ye may witness unto the Father that ye do always remember me. And if ye do always remember me, ye shall have my spirit to be with you. Jesus' words in this passage became the basis for the sacrament prayers used by the people of Nephi and the restored church in the latter days. Jesus himself did not partake of the sacrament that he had administered to the people, for he had promised his 11 apostles at the Last Supper in Jerusalem that he would not drink henceforth, that is to say, from that time forward, of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. Jesus further instructed his disciples that if they would do these things, they would be built upon my rock and not upon a sandy foundation. They were to watch and pray always, and pray vocally among the people in the church, as Jesus himself had done among them. Jesus then instructed the multitude that they were to pray always, and to always pray unto the Father in my name. Specifically, they were to pray in your families, that your wives and your children may be blessed. He also commanded them to meet together oft, and to not forbid anyone from joining them in public worship, but to pray for them, for they were to hold up your light that it may shine unto the world. Behold, I am the light which ye shall hold up, that which ye have seen me do. Jesus then instructed his 12 disciples not to allow anyone knowingly to partake of my flesh and blood unworthily when ye shall minister it. He also told them to not cast out unworthy people, but rather to minister and pray for them. These instructions were to prevent condemnation and eliminate disputations among the church. Jesus then touched each of the 12 Nephite disciples and gave them power to bestow the Holy Ghost. The multitude did not hear what Jesus said as he touched his disciples, but his words must have been written down later by Nephi, for they were recorded by Moroni on the gold plates prepared by his father Mormon. Moroni chapter 2, verse 2, quote, "And he called them by name, saying, Ye shall call on the Father in my name in mighty prayer. And after ye have done this, ye shall have power, that to him upon whom ye shall lay your hands, ye shall give the Holy Ghost. And in my name ye shall give it, for thus do mine apostles." Unquote. After this, a cloud overshadowed the multitude that they could not see Jesus, and his 12 disciples witnessed him ascend into heaven. That brings us to the end of this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and give it a like and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download the notes, slideshow, and handouts that I prepare for these lessons. Next week, we'll cover the second and third days of Jesus' ministry, his later appearance to the 12 Nephite disciples, and Mormon's comments that conclude the book of 3rd Nephi. In that lesson, we'll review and discuss 3rd Nephi chapters 19 through 30. See you next time.